All right, next up, I want to invite Ilya to the stage. Ilya is the head of smart contract development. He's developed the Wave Protocol smart contract language RIDE, and here he's going to explain how this can be used to program smart contracts on the Wave platform.
Yeah, so, one. I'm not going to explain the thing that Anna just said, but something a bit different, but weirdly connected to Inal's talk. So, as Sasha mentioned, we in Waves try different approach for smart contracts, like they should be non-Turing complete. And today I'd like to share the insights that we got through this and how do we see the next steps here. Again, RIDE is non-Turing complete programming language. This achieved through the fact that it doesn't have any loops or recursions, so you can estimate the script complexity upfront. That leads to fixed execution cost and no failing transactions. And that's all okay. And this achieved also through the fact that RIDE is functional language, meaning that we separate computation of the effects from applying the effects. Like first you calculate all the data entries that you need to put on chain, and then they're atomically applied. So things like reentrancy attacks are not possible there. But if we try to look at this from wider perspective, we'll see that there is a problem with on-chain application development. And the problem is expressing your business logic there. For example, you want to do some simple thing like send 10% of tokens through airdrop or whatever. What you would want to write is like three lines of code. For each owner, drop 10%, we're done. But what you have to write, and if you're a developer, you might already know the answer. You have to write some function that accepts some array of addresses, and then this function has to be called multiple times, and then you need to prevent like double spending. So, and by double spending, I mean double inflation. So you have to lock your transfer function up until all the airdrops are done. But again, we wanted to do simple thing, and we implemented with very complex piece of logic. The issue is that blockchain leaks abstractions, and it does heavily all the time. For example, if you code in Turing complete language, you have to understand that all issues will occur during runtime. Well, not all of them, of course, but a lot, like things like computational limits, things like effect limitations will occur runtime. If your language is non-Turing complete, like RIDE, yes, you shift perspective. Some of these problems happen during compile time, and this is good, it's not a problem, it's actually a solution. With effects, it's 50-50. But still, when you write your code with your language, like the one that you usually do with off-chain, you don't have any of these troubles. So blockchain leaks that abstraction. And if we look outside of the blockchain industry, we'll see things like Docker, we'll see things like AWS, we'll see multiple JavaScript frameworks and other frameworks. And what they try to achieve is to abstract you from the execution environment, all right? So you just spawn an instance at AWS, or you just create your Docker container. And you abstract away from the execution environment. And that is the one thing blockchain development leaks. So how can we do it? Well, let's say that we have some complex function that gets compiled to some bytecode. Then, at least in theory, we can separate this bytecode to be executed part by part in different blocks or different transactions. How could this be achieved? For example, we start a computation at TX0, then the computation gets suspended, meaning we freeze the stack position and the memory. Then when the continuation is being processed, the memory is restored, the stack position is restored, some computations happen all along, and then the computation gets suspended again, and then again, and then again, and then again. So the execution lifecycle would look something like You deploy your contract, then you invoke some function that puts an application, decentralized application, in sort of continuation mode, meaning that it will be locked in this mode until the function foo is executed completely. So in this mode, only continue function is allowed to be invoked, sort of virtual function. And then the application is unlocked. And this can be synchronous and parallel at the moment. So for example, if you look at the picture, you'll see some red rectangles and green rectangles and other rectangles. Let's say that red rectangle is DApp 1 and green rectangle is DApp 2. And they, in fact, can be run in parallel in different blocks. So first they compute, and then they apply computations. And this can be done while they're all run in parallel. The question is whether this can be achieved atomically. And the problem with atomicity is that, let's say, DApp 1 reads some data from the Oracle. And then in the next continuation transaction, it needs to read another data from the Oracle. In that case, the result would be unknown because it started from one point in blockchain time and continued in the other point in blockchain time. And the result can be really messed up if the data is supposed to be consistent. What can we do about it? Is just to lock all the external data, and by external I mean the data in blockchain but through in different DApps or different oracles. So you read all the information onto your local state of the DApp in step one, then you continue the execution, then the execution results in list of effects already computed, so you can evaluate whether these effects can be applied or not, and when they are applied, your computation is done. The interesting idea is that this can also be sort of financially incentivized. For example, let's say in Waves, invocation for script costs 0.005. If we make it so that continuation function returns you 0.006, network participants will be incentivized to continue other DApps executions. And miners will be incentivized to include these computations onto their blocks. And we can even find some other mechanics emerging. For example, like renting computation power on blockchain at certain miner and other possible mechanics. So, continuous computations through transactions and blocks look possible. It gives you a more straightforward way to develop applications. You don't need to keep the execution model in mind. Again, how you usually do with Docker, how you usually do with AWS and frameworks, and etc. So this is important. You don't need to learn or invent some patterns along the way. As a result, your code is less cluttered, and well, when your code is less cluttered, obviously you decrease the amount of obviously costly errors. And this also can be financially incentivized and, well, bring new mechanics. Of course, there are open questions like which virtual machine should we use? Well, let's say the approach doesn't really specify any, but it can be done in WebAssembly, Ethereum virtual machine, right? There are other abstractions leaking from blockchain layer to the application layer, like accounts and tokens and other entities. Cross-dApp interaction is also a question. So, of course, there's a lot of work to be done here, not just in implementing, but also in thinking through and discussing. So I think it's a good topic to collaborate and to discuss. All right, thank you.